Silvio, thanks so much for joining us today. I think I want to start with the word trust. This is something that we were talking about on the phone the other day. You found blockchain because of the power that it brings to trustless systems. It adds trust. Yet here we are in the wake of FTX and everything that's happened, and the industry has lost trust. How do we bring it back? How do we rebuild that trust?
Thank you, Frank. Well, let me tell you, when we come to FTX and trust, I think there are two opposite forces. The trust of the uninformed who are really confused, you know, FTX with blockchain. They don't understand that there was a classic episode of financial mismanagement, facilitated, by the way, of the cloud of darkness that was nothing to do with the blockchain. And that confusion, it really brought a trust and great shame to the industry, and actually financial damage to, very unfortunate financial damage to a lot of people. But at the same time, at least of the people like us who are informed, it really stiffened up our resolve to base our trust on the transparency of a blockchain. Because if FTX were run on a blockchain, all those things that happened would have not happened, because everybody would have seen what was going on. So it was the lack of transparency that brought down this bad episode. So in some sense, I think this is a proof that whatever we are doing, bringing transparency to financial market and beyond, is really the right thing.
Now, how can you sort of share that message with regulators? Can regulators, in a sense, be replaced to a degree by blockchain, or leverage it to suss out nefarious activity?
So I believe that the blockchain, by the way, is for everybody. Individuals, startups, big enterprises, nations. So everybody can take advantage from this revolutionary technologies. And regulators too. By the way, the same way that smart contracts are not going to replace lawyers, there is always a room for lawyers, but you can automate a lot of things and enable somehow jurists to focus on the more noble part of the law. Same thing with the regulators. Very often, something on a transparent chain prevents you to have to inspect every day. Do you want your office invaded for 6 months by people camping out, opening every drawer, every archive? No, and they don't like it either, because to send a bunch of people somewhere else and to camp out, you know, outside of the city. If you can actually, for instance, things like compliance, right, that takes a lot of effort and a lot of treasury is spelled on compliance, if you can use the blockchain so that you cannot produce a post-dated document, even if you wanted, because unless it's in the chain and in the right number of blocks, in the right segment of blocks, is not there, is an advantage to everybody. And you are a regulator under the proper privacy layer. Of course, only you can see it, but you can stay home and look at everything is done accordingly. Smart contract can prevent somehow some types of security to go in the wrong hands right away. You don't need to inspect anything at all. So I think there is big advantage for blockchain for everybody, including the regulators.
Now, how do you sort of penetrate the market, right? How can you sort of go from a blockchain that maybe is in the top 40 coins to top 20? And how important is it to sort of be sort of in that upper echelon in terms of developer interest, folks building on the chain? Even if you have the best technology, maybe if you don't have the best marketing, it might make things difficult.
So right now, the potential of a blockchain really has remained untapped, right? So there are, yes, applications, but related to the application that really deserve to be on the chain, we are doing very little. So we are having, still experiencing a big, you know, speculation wave. And by the way, there is nothing wrong about it. Historically, are the speculator who go first, right? I mean, America was, first of all, a land of conquistadores. And then became what the great financial engine of the world. So similar, California gold rush. Well, California is an economic powerhouse. So, but the speculation you cannot predict. But I believe that after this speculation goes down, what remains is the blockchain technology and all this incredible transactional platform where things are becoming very secure, very cheap, very fast, with immediate settlement. So just remember, you know, T plus two is the settlement time, right, in the financial market. T is the time of the transaction, and two is the number of days to settle. In 2 days, anything can happen. Russia can invade Ukraine. So if there is a lot of counterpart risk to take care of. If instead we transform it in T plus 2 seconds, wow, what can happen in 2 seconds? So it becomes a much better world for everybody. So I really believe that technology is going to be important and to be technologically ready and positioned for the next really wave of real world application of blockchain is what really matters.
I feel like we have these waves of speculation. We saw it in 2017. We saw it in 2020, 2021. And in each wave within a financial institution, you have these groups. The blockchain groups, and they build, and then once you get to a certain point, I feel like the talent gets frustrated, and then they leave, and then the sort of projects that they had in the works kind of stall out. When do they sort of push through? Because we can all recognize the power of instant settlement, but it seems like they're still very slow moving.
You know, progress actually is slow and then accelerates. So I really believe that this dance of going in and going out, the advantages are so great, Frank, that I think that is going to be a march forward. Not as fast as impatient people like us would like to see it, but there is going to be steady progress, and this blockchain is going to be a major contributor of how we run our lives, our financial market, how we create community, how we create interaction between artists and fans. So that sense of community, this linkage, this safe interaction that the blockchain provides is not going to go away. Only market price fluctuation of this is totally different. We are going to conquer the world, and we're going to make it a better world.
And what will be the inflection point?
So the inflection point is really the adoption, by the way, and the understanding of institutions and regulators that actually, yes, they are busy, and that's their job, right, to extinguish fires, which unfortunately there have been too many recently. But now, the moment in which they realize that blockchain adds value to society, and even can improve the way they themselves work, I think that this is going to be the catalyst in which, you know, every industry is going to go on the blockchain, because it's going to be much better for everybody.
You think part of the, or one of the impediments, is that it's still maybe too hard to build in this space, maybe with Algorand in particular, still need maybe better tooling, better toolkits, and just broadly speaking, there's not enough folks familiar with building out these applications?
Well, traditionally, yes. In the first few years, this has been, it is a new space, you know, very, a sliver of developers, you know, relative to the whole very small piece of developers that develop on the blockchain. But we at Algorand try to develop the best blockchain there is. But in my opinion, what is going to be important is really interoperability, because essentially we tell the world, come to my ecosystem. And then you say, well, yes, come, but to your own ecosystem. And then, you know, it is a one big world which we want to live and love and operate, and nobody wants to see with suspicion, if I commit into a blockchain, I'm going to be stuck there forever. Which one should I choose? So the moment in which we really get serious about interoperability, so that you can choose the blockchain, but whatever you choose for your local operation, you can interoperate with the rest of the world, this is going to be, in my opinion, the inflection point from a technology point of view.
We were talking on the phone, and you compared different blockchains to different foods. I've heard the comparison of blockchains to cities, but not different pastas, perhaps.
Well, you know, food is something that unites the world, I must say, and is great. It's a necessity and becomes an art form and generate camaraderie, friendship. Food is great. It's a great metaphor. And in some sense, yes, we want to see that we, each one of us, different blockchain, have different flavors. And it is right to be so, right? Because if all we did the same thing, it would be very bad world. So the ideal thing is to say, I have an assets, I have so let me choose in the blockchain the one that are best at that. And by the way, nobody is perfect except the Almighty, perhaps, right? But so we are excellent at something because we narrow what we do extremely well. So you may be excellent at one thing, I'm excellent about another thing. So depending on my industry or my my plans are, I may choose one blockchain for the particular need that I have, but then I better be able to interoperate with everybody else. So this interoperability, I think, is really our next frontier. And it's going to be a technological frontier. It's not going to come for free. We should not take any shortcut to interoperability. Because let me tell you, the easiest path to interoperability is to say, trust me, I let you interoperate with any blockchain you want. What blockchain you want to interoperate with? Trust me. So centralization is not the interoperability we look. And even it's not only me, but it's me, you, and a third person now with a plurality, it's three of us. That doesn't work. Blockchain are marvelous because they are decentralized object. And the last thing we want to do is to put interoperability into very few hands. We must have a decentralized approach to interoperability, and this requires, guess what, technology. Without technology, there is no blockchain. And sticking to food, there is no free lunch, okay? So blockchain needs technology, interoperability needs even more technology.
So what dish would Algorand be? Is it a filet?
Well,
sea bass?
If you ask me, my favorite food is really a parmigiana, eggplant parmigiana, which the way my mother used to do it. It's not for everybody, but if you are an eggplant lover, there is nothing better in the world when it's done well.
Yeah, it's really good. He made it for me once. So, but interoperability from a technology perspective is really terrifying. Because in terms of if you get it wrong, if you take a shortcut, because the bridging situation that we've seen the hacks, we've seen the exploits.
Yeah. So first of all, we should really do it right, okay? Because interoperability even elevates the bar for technological excellence. So first of all, we have seen the bridges and we've seen bridges collapsing. And the reason these bridges collapse, by the way, is the fact they are centralized bridges. So first of all, the real bridges are decentralized bridges. So I have my asset in a blockchain A because I trust blockchain A. That's where I put my asset. I want to transfer now to blockchain B because I believe B is a cool, well-run blockchain.
I agree.
Excellent. So now what do we do? Ideally, I don't want to trust anybody else. I trust A, I trust B as the two blockchain. Why should I trust somebody in the middle? So a decentralized bridge is that if you trust the two blockchain, you don't have to trust anybody else. Of course, it takes a bit more technology to do that. And we at Algorand, we generated state proofs and all kinds of technology that enable you to run a decentralized bridge. We are not in the business, right? We are a technology company, Algorand Inc., and Algorand is a blockchain. We don't run bridges ourselves, but we give you the tools to run decentralized bridges. But this notion of moving assets from one blockchain to another in a secure, decentralized way is great, but it's just the beginning. Interoperability, that is the first case of interoperability. You really want to interact with the assets of every blockchain that there is out there directly, and not only transfer the asset to one blockchain so that you could be serviced over there, and therefore everybody has to migrate to one. We'll still be talking, you know, you move to my blockchain, and then, no, you move to ours. Actually, you should move to her blockchain, right? Instead, we want to leave assets where they are and still be able to interact with them. That is really the bar for interoperability, and yes, ought to be decentralized. And then at this point, you may choose whatever blockchain you want, but my advice is to choose a blockchain which is really technologically superior once you know that you can interact with everybody else.
No one blockchain to rule them all, as it were. So which industry or use case do you think Algorand is primed to dominate? And do you think that's the approach that a blockchain organization should take? Should we figure out what we're best at, to your point earlier, nail that, and then expand outwards?
The choice of who is best belongs to the people, right? To the user, to they should make the choice. And I think dominate, we all have dreams about the domination. I think the honest dream is to be, to do the best we can and try to do really, really well, and so that we attract users. So we are, as a blockchain, you know, we are a platform which everybody's able to build. We have companies like AgroToken that somehow tokenize a grain that gives liquidity to farmers right away when they need it. We have a project like TravelX, which is the travel ticket is the last financial instrument without a secondary market. I love that application because in some sense we want to become again owners, not just licensee of things. And we want to own, that's my damn ticket, and I can sell it to whoever I want. And so I can go to visit Italian friends and relatives there. I buy free tickets because I don't know when I'm going to use. I use one of them, and the other two, I sell it. And I can prove that I'm the legitimate owner because in the last block I own it. You see it. I can see that you have real money. So we do an atomic transfer swap of money. The thing done. We don't need to be aided by anybody. So all this stuff, which we become, again, owner of our information, our assets, is an important thing. But we are also open. We have the scalability to serve nations. So we open Algorand labs in Europe, in Rome, actually, to help, you know, a European institution to move on the chain and try to convince, you know, people to do that. And we have the scalability. We have actually a wonderful set of layer one smart contract that enable to do a lot of smart things in a single transaction. So by the same transaction, not a sequence of transactions. Mm. Nothing is more secure if you and I want to swap asset by virtue of the same transaction. Because the chain stalls, ever forbidden, doesn't stall, doesn't matter, because if in one block I own the asset, you own the money, in the next block, you own the money and I own the asset. So that is, or if something happens, you are in control of your asset, I'm in control of my money. That's it. So that we are positioned to attract all kinds of things. We certainly have the scale and the layer one smart contract to serve even big institutions or even governments.
If anyone hears from Ticketmaster, take note. He's coming for you. I guess to close out, just what may be going back to the topic of trust at the top of the session, what are some concrete plans or initiatives does Algorand have underway that can sort of rebuild the trust of the industry?
I really go back to that. How do we rebuild the trust of the industry? First, not only Algorand, but each and every one of our travel companions, the other blockchain. We have to build better technology. We must make sure that we have no downtime. We must make sure that, you know, our tech works, and we certainly are proud of that. We must sure that, you know, our technology keeps on evolving, and we actually embedded this in the DNA of Algorand, the ability to consensually upgrade the technology. And we have, in my opinion, to be show that we are good and beneficial, even our platforms are beneficial for institutions. If we do that, bring institutional players, central banks and others to play on our great platforms, I think we do a favor to ourselves and to an entire industry. And that is the way to build trust, a better technology, and convincing actually that this is so safe and so good that institutions should take advantage of it.
Great. Thank you, Silvio.